The next presenter is Dr. Santosh Krishnappa.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Santosh from JJ Institute of Cardiology. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers, chairperson, moderators for giving me an opportunity. See, my case basically is a 65-year-old gentleman, in fact, my own medical class teacher, who felt apparently healthy. All of us feel we are immune to medical illness being doctors. We don't get health evaluation done frequently. He does not have any conventional risk factors like diabetes or other conventional risk factors. He had limited physical activities. He presented to us with a history of backache for 2 days, which is off and on lasting for 5 to 10 minutes. And maybe 30 minutes before he presented to us on the given day. He was in pulmonary edema. BP was around 50. Systolic, when he came to the ICU, he was on inotropes. Because he was a medical school teacher in a small city, tier 2 city in Mysore. A lot of students just came in, and a lot of confusion they created. And his evaluation showed extensive ST elevations in anterolateral leads with EF 25%. Then we took him for cath lab. That's what we encountered. See, whenever we see this kind of a scenario, this most unwanted, an emergency, you can see left main is totally cut off. But usually, it's high volume center we work with, and maybe on 250 angioplasties we do. And once in 2 to 3 months, we see this kind of a cut off. A lot of times, the patient will be on CPR, and if they enter cath lab alive, usually they come out alive in this kind of scenario. It's a total left main cut off. I think it's not going to loop. But in this case, what exactly happened was it was very tough. Usually, left main lesions in acute scenario will be soft. Once you wire, you establish flow into LAD and LCX, the patient give us sufficient time to breathe and plan the strategy. But in this case, even though we took him up very early inside into the cath lab, not waiting for any kind of a report, it was very tough. We could not cross easily. It was quite tough. Ultimately, the wire went to ram us with a balloon support. I'm sorry for the images not being run. You can see it's a tough lesion. Ultimately, the wire went to LCX. We usually use a Cougar XT as a workhouse wire. And with the balloon support, it went in, then directed the Then we tried entering LAD, we could not. Then we thought we'll establish flow into LCX. With great difficulty, we could wire LCX with one more Cougar XT with a balloon support. Initially, before taking a left shoot, we had taken a right shoot because this patient had a distribution of anterior leads. The RC was normal with the distillery getting opacified from the RC retrogradely. Then we thought, why not we try LAD from just having a retrograde as a landmark. Then I asked my colleague to punch up the other drawing and cannulate the RCA. I thought, we'll just give a try. See, at this point of time, there were 2-3 things going on in my mind. Whether LAD is a CTO. If LAD is a CTO, in this acute scenario of pulmonary edema with cardiac shock, establishing flow into LCX and RAMAS is sufficient enough. But if you go with the clinical scenario, acute presentation, pulmonary edema, EF of 25%, with the LAD territory being ischemic, I was not sure whether really it's going to benefit him or not. The multiple cardiologists entered the lab, started giving inputs, a lot of confusion created. Then thought, we'll try to open LAD, just give 5 more minutes, like kept on trying. First, initially, I took a Cougar XT, which I could not advance. Then, because we had some problem with the hardware on the given day with a high ABP not functioning, then went, pierced the initial cap with a Miracle 12 grams. Then it was not going through. Then exchanged that with a Pilot 50. Ultimately, with the help of retrograde injection, we went going to diagonal. It was giving some hope because we're going entering diagonal septal, and ultimately we could enter the distal LAD. Once we entered the distal LAD, I think things are simple. Yeah, we planned two distal stents for LAD and LCX, 3:32 into LAD and 2.732 into LCX distally. And subsequently, at the bifurcation, because the angle was wide, we thought we'll go with the modified T. Usually, I use a balloon for a modified T. This is a 3:32 serializing the leading stent into LCX. Then, left main to LAD was placed in. It was crossed from a distal strut. Then, as usual, did a final kissing balloon, then a pot, then this is the final result. And maybe it took around 25 minutes. The patient gave sufficient time for us to revascularize. He improved, went home on day 5. He's doing well. And to conclude, left main occlusion always is an unwanted emergency. Seconds, fraction of seconds do matter. If these patients enter cath lab alive, they usually go out alive. That's what it matters. Established flow to LAD and L6 is always the basic necessity. And when this kind of a scenario is encountered, if you have a CT of LAD, it's always a turmoil or enigma whether to go ahead with opening LAD or just securing LCX and RAMUS is sufficient enough, and to leave it to the surgeons to tackle LAD or come back and do later. Under some inputs from my few of my colleagues to send the patient for immediate surgery, I don't think any surgeon would have dared to take this kind of a patient in pulmonary edema for emergency CABG addressing all the three. Thank you all.
I think the issue here was LAD was not accessed with the conventional wire, then the higher level wires. You could not get the LAD, and that's why you started thinking of CTO, right?
That's right, sir.
Yeah, I think we should always consider that this is going to be an acute problem. I mean, the clinical scenario, as you yourself said, was so dramatic that circumflex alone couldn't have produced such a scenario.
That's so always a confusion, sir, in this kind of scenario. But it was actually, in fact, distal left main was so tough to cross. We encounter a lot of this kind of scenario where wire just slips through, where whichever, you go to some one or the other vessel. In this case, it was so tough, even to enter a RAMUS initially, it was very, very tough. The feel
I mean, I would just put this as a difficult wiring case, but not really call it a CTO. I don't know whether everybody
No, sir. This type of situation in the real world we are seeing, actually, the mechanism of CTO, in majority of cases after MI, it becomes tough and proximal cap will be tough and CTOs will be there. But small percentage of cases we have seen these type of acute on chronic type of CTOs. Slowly the stable plot become progress, it becomes too tiny the channel. At that time, the patient present with acute coronary syndrome. So these routine wires won't pass. Definitely you have to take the CTO material. This is a similar type of presentation encountered also in the real world. So many cases. And only the soft whites won't go.
No,
you
I'm
have to take CTO hardware and good collaterals and good distal vessels will be seen like these situations. That's why we present like acute and chronic CTOs like. So clinical presentation is acute, but lesion-wise it looks like a chronic CTO.
I mean, you have to use CTO wires, but still we cannot call this as a true CTO.
Yeah, clinical situations.
We cannot call it a true CTO.
Talk about CTOs, but a long-standing CTO like more than 1 year or less than 1 year, the pathophysiology differ. In this kind of scenario where you don't have bridging collaterals, which is not very long, maybe a subacute kind of scenario, but the problem is none of the regular wires, even the Fielder XT was not able to pierce the initial the proximal cap. Maybe Miracle 12 grams, once it pierced the proximal cap, we thought the rest of the wire could...
No, whatever you did is actually a good thing. So these small subset will come, and whatever you did appropriate, the, say taking CTO hardware and opening the vessel in acute situations. But in general, what I have seen is unlike a thrombotic situations, which will behave in a malignant way, this won't behave in a malignant way. It will give some breathing time actually, comparatively what I have seen in the clinical scenario.
And don't call for surgeons. Thank you indeed. We move on to the next presenter, Sunil Benival.
Very good morning to all of you. With the permission of Chairperson, I'm presenting some different tests in front of you. So my case is slightly different intervention in a case of stroke. So we will go in a case. So my case is a 52-year-old male. He's a known hypothyroidist, but well controlled with the thyroid drugs. He's a slightly dyslipidemic. Other factor known is non-hypertensive, non-diabetic, and non-smoker. And he presented in neurology department with the history of left side neck weakness for one day. And this was associated with the vertigo. On examination, blood pressure is within normal limit. He's well alert, conscious. He's a slight weakness on left side, and left plantar was extension, and other things are within normal limits. He has slight anemia and other things normal. MRI shows patchy acute infarct in left cerebral hemisphere, and which is suggestive of border zone infarct. He underwent carotid Doppler, and which shows 80% to 90% luminal narrowing in the right IC. So then this case was referred to us for DSA. And this is the diagnostic angiogram DSA. It shows nearly 95% to 99% occlusion of the ICA, internal carotid artery ostium. So this is a patient presented with a stroke, and this is the second day after the stroke, and with the minimal weakness. So we want to salvage as much as possible, because in the literature we can see that in the first week or after 2 weeks there are more chances of developing the full-blown stroke. So patient and family was counseled for carotid angioplasty, and we put a 7-French shuttle sheath from the right groin into the CCA over the emplacer wire. Till then everything is fine. I mean, as soon as we remove the our guide wire through the ECA, the patient has some involuntary movement and had slurring of speech. We want to talk to him, but he couldn't say what he wanted to say. And he suddenly becomes tachypneic. He had tachycardia and BP race. He couldn't move his left side and is only moving his right side. He's very dead. So we took another angiogram with the shuttle sheath, and now we can see there the complete occlusion of the IC from the ostium. So a patient intubated immediately, and GA was administered because patient was very agitated at that time. And after that, blood pressure and heart rate was partially controlled. So now the options to us are whether we should terminate the procedure and do a systemic IV thrombolysis, which is the standard for a case of acute stroke within 4.5 hours. Or we have an intra-arterial ulcer, so at that time we can go ahead with the intra-arterial thrombolysis. There is a role of GP2B3 inhibitor, but this is not, this is a controversial role in the acute thrombus. We can continue procedures with the digital protection device, or as there is a large thrombus, we can continue without. So we have lots of options in our mind what we go ahead. So what we proceed, we just give an intra-carotid tirofiban because we thought this is acute thrombus formation, we may get away with GP2B inhibitors as a bolus dose in the carotid artery, but there is no flow. Then the second step, we have intra-arterial access, so we tried intra-arterial thrombolysis with the LT place. And this is the picture just after intra-arterial thrombolysis, with small trickling of flow, now going into the ICU. So with this small flow, we have decided to close the lesion, and with the help of the multipurpose coronary catheter, and we put a normal routine coronary wire across that lesion, and we are lucky enough to just after crossing the wire, there is a sufficient flow into the cerebral circulation, and there is no intracerebral migration of the thrombus at that time. So we just did a balloon dilatation at the local site, and followed by we put a self-expanding stent just after that. This is the neutrinol stent, 16:8, 40 millimeter long stents. And this is the picture after putting a stent. So there is a small residual stenosis at the bifurcation site, but there is a good flow into the distal ICA and the intracerebral circulation. So we waited for 15 minutes on the table, and there is no deterioration of the flow, no thrombus formation. We didn't do the post dilatation because we have a risk to migration of that thrombus which was covered by the stent. Then patient shifted to ICU, next to it after 2 hours. Patient recovered well, and we are lucky enough that he doesn't have any residual weakness on the day of discharge on day 3rd. So the rare things in this case, this is a rare case of acute strike in front of us in cath lab. All the options were tried. We did the thrombolysis, we give a GP2 with the emitter, and then complete the carotid intervention. The things to learn, we should not panic, and we should discuss what are the options available to us. And critical care team is very helpful in this situation too. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, Prasad, you want to have? There's a mic here.
The risk of bleeding would have increased.
We have
both 2B3 inhibitors plus thrombolysis plus heparin.
Can you just repeat the questions for the audience?
Yeah. The question was, instead of, since we have all our equipment in place.
The mic is not on, sir. Sunil, you can repeat the question.
So the question was that whether we should not try for GP2B inhibitor tyrosine and just go for the intra-arterial thrombolysis as a first step. So this may be option. This is definitely a viable option. But at that time, this is a large artery, and from acute thrombus formation in front of us, and the duration is the 5 to 10 minutes. We have an experience in the coronary intervention. We just try just a bolus dose of the intra-arterial tyrosine, and there might be some flow into that artery. That's why we tried. Otherwise, definitely the intra-arterial thrombolysis is a proven therapy that we can go ahead.
Of issues is there. If you carefully see the film, you should be very gentle, especially threatened occlusion. Actually, if you careful, this is a thrombus with a threatened occluding internal carotid artery, ostium. So you should be gentle enough when you are pushing with extra wire. It seems going almost up to almost thyroid, this one.
Yeah.
That means it might be disturbed, that one. It will call acute threatened closure. And producing the seizures and infarct, almost presentation is TIA. Then it goes into the established. Luckily, it happened in front of the cath lab,
actually.
So that the situation is in your control.
Yeah.
So definitely, without thrombolysis also you can put them. But thrombolysis gave some breathing time, rather than 2B3, which is a offline label of giving a 2B3 blocker. You can give intra-arterial thrombolysis, which was established modality of treatment, some breathing time. Then you did under protection is most important. Very important is because unlike a brain tissue, unlike a heart tissue, it can't tolerate the no reflow phenomena. And these patients are sometimes the penumbra region will expand sometimes. And may produce sometimes residual defects. Luckily, this patient is, the stars are very good on that day, and the patient is also very well recovered.
So this is my first case which I did without deep distal protection device because we are
in a panic state, I can understand. Yeah. It is in a panic
most
state.
Of the time, we always use the DPD and the calcium carotid intervention.
No, I think this case also highlights the timing of the procedure. I think the patient had a clear prolonged weakness the previous day. So it was probably a little bit more than just a TIA.
Yeah.
So you should rely a lot on the MR, and if MR is showing any kind of infarct, the procedure probably should have been delayed by about 8 days. So in this period, maybe he should have been on Clexane. And then you could have done the same procedure 8 days later with a lot more safety than trying to do it in a very hot stage.
The procedure-wise, this might be more safety, but if we go through literature-wise, the most of these infarcts turning into massive infarct in the first 14 days. So the risk-benefit ratio will be more in the first 14 days than if we given or later than. This is what the literature is adding us. Definitely, this was a procedure-wise, this is more risky if you are dealing with the acute procedure.
We reviewed this for ESC. I think it's pretty clear that if it is a TIA, you would wait, especially when you take the first picture and you see so much thrombus. You know, my strategy would have been, once the patient is presented, do just a CT angio, which gives you enough information, clearly more than an MR angio. And if you see a thrombus, back out, you know, because it's not like a coronary
thrombus.
We go
through CT angio. There is a pinch of thrombus, but that not so much that we can. There looks like a tight lesion instead of more thrombus.
I think the way we are moving is clearly a carotid angio. Angioplasty are always together these days because it's so much easier to get maximum information with CT. So we have enough information, plan your strategy and go for the stenting.
Definitely.
So I would very strongly feel that the stenting
was
too
premature.
What is the dose of Altiplase you have given?
We have dose, used the 0.3 milligram per kg over the 10 minutes of the period. And we have searched for the literature, but there is no definite the proven dose for the intra-arterial thrombolysis. Recent trials have given up to 0.6 milligram per kg dose of the intra-arterial. We have given 0.3 milligram per kg.
People are trying tenecteplase instead of Altiplase nowadays for the CVA, acute CVA. Yeah. There is studies are also.
Altiplase is the most research molecule for that intra-arterial thrombolysis for the intra stroke.
Actually, under tenseful situation, it did.
Thank you.
Very nice.